makes this man with all the love that his heart can stand. Dream of ways to throw it all away.
Good morning, Endeavor, and a special good morning today to you, Scorch.
Thanks, Shannon. Why'd you turn the music off so quick? I'd like to thank my family for that nice selection of a song. Seems kind of appropriate, and we're excited to get off to a great day with our EVA team getting outside.
Airlock Houston on 2. We've got the airlock video on downlink 3. Just wanted to let you know that we're coming on board there. Okay, and we see the hand signal. Thanks.
And our first view of today's spacewalkers, Rick Mastracchio on the right, who will be extravehicular crew member number one, Dave Williams at the bottom of your screen, as the third Canadian to walk in space today in the footsteps of Chris Hadfield and Steve McLean. Obviously, he'll be wearing the spacesuit bearing the Canadian flag, the maple leaf. Dave Williams will be extravehicular crew member number two, wearing the pure white suit. Mastracchio's suit will bear the red stripes on the knees and the elbows. Flight engineer Clay Anderson working with Mastracchio and Williams as they begin to put on the lower torso portion of their extravehicular mobility unit. Scott Kelly, the commander, now in the field of view, who is the overall suit choreographer, helping the crew suit up and check out the systems. The crew running slightly ahead of schedule. Mastracchio and Williams spent last night in the Quest airlock in the campout procedure that began the process of removing nitrogen from their bloodstreams in a iterative process that prevents any condition known as the bends from developing. Vacuum decompression sickness when they step out into the void of space later today. Canadian Space Agency astronaut Dave Williams about to move into the crew lock, the outermost compartment of the Quest airlock, assisted by Clay Anderson. Rick Mastracchio already in the crew lock as we near the point for the start of the closing of the hatch and the depressurization of the crew lock prior to the start of today's spacewalk. This spacewalk, the 12th spacewalk conducted this year, the 89th in support of station assembly and maintenance.
Houston Station for Robo on 2.
Scorch, go ahead on Space Ground 2.
Is there an accelerate button on this machine?
The dry humor of test pilot Charlie Hobaugh being exhibited.
And Scorch on Space Ground 2, was it going too fast? Were you looking to slow it down?
A little time consuming, thanks.
Marine Colonel Charlie Hobaugh, Endeavor's pilot, used to high performance aircraft, deliberately maneuvering the Canadarm2, the robotic arm from the robotics workstation of the Destiny Laboratory, with the S5 truss attached to the end of Canadarm2. Inside the Destiny Laboratory, Charlie Hobaugh at the robotics workstation, along with Clay Anderson in the foreground, Oleg Kotov, the Expedition 15 flight engineer, who later today will be working with Commander Fyodor Yurchikhin in the initial checkout of cables that will be involved in the replacement of the Russian computer commanding unit that failed during the STS-117 mission back in June. 5 days of work totaling about 28 hours of Kotov and Yurchikhin's time will be spent starting today and over the next 4 days to replace that commanding unit and bring the Russian computer system and the Zvezda service module back to its original state. And now back in the equipment lock of the Quest airlock, Tracy Caldwell on the right, Commander Scott Kelly on the left, having closed the hatch to the crew lock, standing by for the formal approval to begin the depressurization of the crew lock. a good view of the two-ton S5 truss affixed to the end of Canadarm2. Pilot Charlie Hobaugh maneuvering this new component for the International Space Station to the pre-installed position at the end of the starboard truss section of the International Complex. This view showing the S5 truss moving into position in the pre-installed position to be aligned precisely and then mated to the end of the S4 truss. You can see at the upper right-hand portion of your screen one of the beta gimbal assemblies. This essentially the canister that helped deploy the solar arrays for the S4 truss back on the STS-117 mission back in June.
Okay, the hatch is open. The thermal cover's open, Scott.
Okay, the hatch is stowed.
It's stowed, yep.
Okay, post deep breaths. On your DCMs, I want you to do a staggered. You'll get a warning tone when you do it. Rick first, and that is power to bat.
Okay.
This is Mission Control Houston. The outer thermal hatch is open. The start of today's spacewalk officially clocked at 11:28 a.m. Central Time as Endeavour and the International Space Station cross the equator over the Pacific Ocean, passing from northwest to southeast, just off the northern coast of Australia. With the thermal cover open and the hatch now opened, the first spacewalker out will be Rick Mastracchio. He will leave the airlock and attach an 85-foot-long safety tether to the airlock handrail, locking the hook and preparing to be joined outside by Dave Williams, who is about to become the third Canadian to walk in space, joining Chris Hadfield and Steve McClain.
Okay, visors as required.
It's dark.
We have a go for crew lock egress, and Houston, if you can get step 13.
Okay, we'll put step 13 in work.
And Tracy, over to you.
Thanks, Scott. How are you guys doing?
Doing good, Tracy.
Doing great.
Okay, I see you guys coming out the airlock. I heard that the hooks were locked and the reels are unlocked. You got the thermal hatch cover open. Coming out, Rick, your first safety tether is going to handrail 0550.
Copy.
Tracy Caldwell acting as the spacewalk choreographer today, following the suit-up activities that were overseen by Commander Scott Kelly.
Okey-dokey. Over here. Yeah. Forward side. Gonna get my left fleece tether on here. Lock mic on mic. And easy, easy. Thermal covers come and go. That band is gonna hold it.
Our first helmet camera view, this coming from the helmet camera affixed to Rick Mastracchio as he moves toward the vicinity of the S4 truss to begin the removal of launch locks along with Dave Williams.
APFR position.
Okay.
214 miles below the Pacific Ocean as Mastracchio and Williams set up shop along the starboard truss segment of the International Space Station.
Right. Good.
Thanks very much.
good. You could just hang out there and wait for Rick.
Okay, Trey, they're leading them, boys. Here comes the BRT.
Copy that.
Okay, Trey, the back tethered on 22-06.
Copy.
Rick Mastracchio on the left, Dave Williams on the right, as they assess the position of soft capture pins.
You got it. With the socket.
At the end of the S4 truss, to which S5 will be attached a short time from now.
Hey, for Rick and Dave, just let me know when you're ready to move in. We're all set to go on this end, and the first move will just be to the launch lock removal position.
Okay, copy that, Squirt.
Mastracchio has verified the correct configuration for the portable foot restraint that has been set up at the end of the S4 truss. He and Dave Williams will soon be in a position to provide what is known as GCA, or guided control assist, for pilot Charlie Hobaugh, as Hobaugh operates the Canadarm2 to slowly maneuver the S5 truss in for its alignment and a soft capture to the end of the S4 truss attachment.
Over to Scorch for the DCA.
Okay. Four bar linkages, I think all look okay.
Yeah.
And looking at the FSU RTS housing clearance, that looks nominal, Scorch, so.
Yeah, it looks like I got good four bar linkage clearance down here, so. Dave, if you're happy.
Yeah, I'm happy.
We could have Scorch move into the launch lock removal position.
Okay, and my safety tether is clear, my hands are clear.
Same here. Of course, you with us?
All right, Rick, if you're ready, here we go.
Yep.
Hobaugh now will slowly maneuver S5 to a closer position to where Mastracchio and Williams are so that they can begin to use pistol grip tools to remove a series of four launch locks around the corners of the boxy S5 truss segment. The S5 will be positioned now to within 6 to 12 inches away from the S4 capture latch assembly.
One thing, there is a cable, looks like a VGA cable, that is sticking up. I don't know if you can see it on my helmet cam, Trace.
Is it going to be a factor or not, Rick?
You are going to hit that cable, but I'm hoping that it'll push the cable below it. Well, I can't reach it, but you see the four-bar linkage? See the thick power cable?
Yeah, I see it.
SSU clearance with the RTS looks nominal. Clarence looks here. For the four-bar linkage, it's good. You're definitely going to hit that cable, though, Scorch. The cable's going to stick up about 4 inches into the envelope.
You think we're going to hit it?
Oh, you're definitely going to hit it. It's just a question of what happens if it pushes it out of the way.
Okay, we're good to continue, then?
I would say so.
Okay.
And Scorch Corner 2, you're good to continue. You're now getting handrail overlap with the SSU clearance nominal.
And thank you.
As you make contact with that cable, Scorch, as I see how it moves, I'll ask you to stop if I have to, if necessary. Then I'll have to go push it, maybe.
Okay, it's a cable in front of the four-bar linkage. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, it's a cable, actually. It's nadir of the four-bar linkage. It's the power cable. Those are the VGA, looks like.
Okay, I'm going to try to watch it in your helmet, Jim.
Yeah. Coming in contact with it about two inches or so.
Okay. Got about 45 centimeters to go.
Good clearance. Copy that. The RTS is just coming inboard of the SSU.
Okay, you're contacting the cable now. Looks like it might be pushing. I don't know which is moving, the cable or the S5. Looks like you might be stalling out. Now you're still moving.
Yeah, I still see motion.
Cable is going below it, but it looks like it's slowing you down a little bit. Looks like it's working okay.
It looks looks like we'll get over the hump here in a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. And scorch the RTOS is inboard of the SSU.
And Houston, you're good to continue, I understand, correct?
You're just about clear of the cable now, scorch, starting to...
Sounds good. Looks like we're over that cable now.
Yep, looks like you're over the hump pretty much.
5 centimeters to go.
Copy. Good clearance with a handrail in the SSU. Same here.
Okay, we're at the launch lock removal position. Stand by.
Okay.
The S5 truss now within 12 inches of S4.
SRMS is break. Tracy, over to you.
Thanks, Scorch. Hey, guys, before you get...
That sets the stage for the removal of the series of four launch locks that will enable S5 then to be moved into a fine alignment position for its capture to the S4.
And do not apply a push or pull force or side load while driving the primary bolt.
Copy. Tracy,
thank you.
A good view of Rick Mastracchio as he also prepares to join Dave Williams for the removal of launch locks there on opposite sides of the S5 truss segment. At the very top of your screen is the end effector of Canadarm 2 that is firmly grappled to one of the two grapple fixtures on S5.
On the PGT, good type test.
On the socket?
Yeah, I'll keep you in the loop. Just getting it right now. Hey. ATC, the socket is installed on the PGT, or on the red, I should say. Good tug test. And just, you know, put the socket caddy back on my mini workstation.
Copy, Dave. Thanks.
Now, Mastracchio, in his portable foot restraint. Again, the two spacewalkers will be using pistol grip tools simultaneously to remove launch locks from either of two corners. There are four corners where all of the launch locks must be removed, four of them, in order to provide the capability for S5 to be placed in a position where it can be captured to S4 and then bolted into place.
Bravo 1, counterclockwise.
DC, I'm turning.
Okay.
Copy, Bravo 1.
This view from Dave Williams' helmet camera as he begins the use of a pistol grip tool, 54 turns. To remove launch lock number 2 from its position on the S5 truss. Again, this view of Rick Mastracchio wearing the suit, bearing the red stripes, Dave Williams in the far right corner of your picture as they work on opposite sides of the S5 truss, removing a set of four launch locks, which will set the stage for pilot Charlie Hobaugh to continue moving the Canadarm 2, the robotic arm that you see at the very top of your picture, grappled onto the S5 truss for its attachment to S4.
No more than 36, but back it out until you see at least 2.
Okay. I got the launch lock off, Trace. And the bolt head is reset, or the bolt is reset. Let me just check. Yes. 2 shreds at the shoulder, TC. Bolt head is fully reset.
How many more turns was it?
That was 3 turns.
3 turns extra?
Yes.
So about 30 turns total.
That's correct.
Good job, Dave. Hey, Rick, how many turns did you have?
It was 48 turns at the PGT. Stand by and I'll check how many threads I've got showing.
Did you say 48 at the PGT?
Yes. So that's 24.
24, yeah.
And the bolt is definitely recessed. We And just check how many threads you got. And TC, the launch lock is in my trash bag.
Copy.
And just wondering if I can get a go to head over to corner four.
Right after you configure your rad for translation.
And the rad is configured for translation.
And you gotta go.
Thanks very much. Okay.
Once S5 is soft captured on a series of soft capture pins onto the S4 truss, then the two spacewalkers will begin to torque down a series of four bolts to permanently mate the two segments.
Okay, let's give it a shot.
So, Dave, you're in position?
Yeah, I'm in position corner two.
I am also.
My safety tether is clear, TC. My hands are clear.
Same here. Scorcher, go.
Keep your hands and feet inside the vehicle at all times. Here we go.
Copy. Good motion.
Sure.
Corner two, course alignment cone is entering the plane.
Same at corner three. Looks like we're going to need a little bit of right, maybe. Just starting the rub.
Corner two is going up.
Corner three is going up. Yep. Keep it coming a little
keep
more.
Coming. Keep it coming. Two is up. Four is going up.
Three
keep
one
coming.
Up.
George, it looks perfect. Perfect. Three down.
Three is down.
Four is yet to go.
One is up. One is still up also.
Okay, so we got two and three, and one and four need to come down. Looks like. Do you agree, Rick?
Do you agree?
Okay.
Precision flying of the S5 truss, courtesy of the Canadarm2 by pilot Charlie Hobaugh, with the assistance of flight engineer Clay Anderson of the Destiny Laboratory.
The board's up as well. Hey, nice view in your visor.
Hey, the arm is limp. I'm going to give it about 30 seconds.
Okay.
Hobaugh allowing relative motion of the Canadarm2 to dampen out a bit before he proceeds on for the soft capture of the other two corners of the S5 truss to the S4.
Gonna head over corner four.
Corner four is down.
Affirmative.
We understand all corners are down.
I agree.
You're correct. Right, give us a second.
Okay.
S5 soft captured to the S4 truss segment.
NTC, I'm just heading back. Corner two.
Copy, Dave. We have you getting in the APFR and then waiting for Rick to finish bolt one.
This view from Dave Williams' helmet camera as he and Rick Mastracchio now are in the final stages of torquing down the four bolts, permanently mating the S5 truss to the starboard four truss segment. And the removal of the soft capture pins that were used to align the mating of the two truss components at the beginning of today's spacewalk, which is now 1 hour, 52 minutes in duration.
I can't read the display on the PTT with the sunlight, and I've got a little bit of fogging going on, so I'm just cooling down.
Okay, take your time, we're ahead. And if you're ready, I'll give you the PGT settings for the grounding strap install.
Stand by one. I just have to do a couple turns manually.
Okay, take your time.
Okay.
If you guys want to check your helmet lights off, you can do that.
Okay, stand by. I'm just going to leave mine on. There you are, Rick.
Rick, stand right
above you.
I see it.
Okay. There you go. Okay, thanks.
Got it.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to proceed to read that adjustable sphere lead.
Okay, and I'm sorry, one more thing. Did you say you were going to leave the third lead?
I've already picked it up.
Okay.
All right, corner three is torqued to click. Barely an eighth of a turn.
Copy that, Rick.
Koparazinski, BRT, no problem.
We'll make a note of it.
This is Mission Control Houston. Approaching the two-hour mark into today's spacewalk by Rick Mastracchio and Dave Williams, the spacewalk team in the International Space Station Flight Control Room reports all four bolts now hard-mated, the starboard five truss now permanently attached to the starboard four truss segment. The two spacewalkers now will be working to remove a grapple fixture on the S5 truss segment that was used for the handoff between the shuttle robotic arm and the station's robotic arm yesterday during the initial unberthing of S5 from Endeavour's payload bay and the handoff to the Canadarm2, the station robotic arm. This grapple fixture on S5, now that it is permanently installed on the truss segment of the International Space Station, interferes with the rotation of the beta gimbal assembly for one of the two solar array wings on the S4 truss that was installed back on the STS-117 mission in June. So the spacewalking crew must remove this grapple fixture and relocate it to the keel position on S5. The keel is essentially the mounting platform upon which the S5 was launched in the payload bay.
Hey, Dave, we'll take a look at your gloves when you're ready.
Okay, now would be a good time. Gloves. Looks good. Right glove. Looks good. And the view is incredible.
That's awesome. Good reporting.
Two hours, 16 minutes into today's spacewalk. Rick Mastracchio and Dave Williams working on the S5 truss segment, now a permanent fixture on the International Space Station, as the station and Endeavour begin to approach the west coast of South America, moving from southwest to northeast, soon to cross the equator at an altitude of 214 statute miles. This 12th spacewalk of the year, the 89th spacewalk in support of station assembly and maintenance, going by the book so far, in fact, ahead of schedule, as the spacewalkers Mastracchio wearing the suit, bearing the red stripes, Dave Williams behind him toward the bottom of your screen, each in their first spacewalk running about 45 minutes ahead of the timeline as they begin to work to relocate a grapple fixture from one location to the keel portion, basically at the base of the S5 truss. The keel was the implement upon which the S5 truss was launched in the payload bay of Endeavour. The relocation of this grapple fixture is required to enable one of the two solar wings, the 3A wing, on the starboard four truss segment. The beta gimbal assembly must rotate to enable the solar array to position itself properly in relation to being able to track the sun. It cannot rotate unless this grapple fixture is relocated. And so using a pistol grip tool, Rick Mastracchio, whose helmet camera view you're looking at right now, along with Dave Williams, will unbolt this grapple fixture and relocate it to the keel. The grapple fixture also can be used in the future as a spare in the event another such grapple fixture does not work on another one of the components that could be moved from one location to another on the International Space Station.
Copy that, Rick.
Let me know when you're starting. Okay, here we go.
we're watching the clearances with the solar ray box.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I feel motion.
Williams carefully maneuvering the grapple fixture and its frame.
This is taking me away.
Over to the keel side of the S5 truss.
Okay. All right.
As you can see, there are actually two grapple fixtures. One was grappled by the shuttle robotic arm to lift the S5 out of Endeavour's payload bay yesterday. The other grapple fixture was used to hand off this S5 truss segment from the shuttle arm to the station arm yesterday in preparation for its installation earlier this afternoon.
Little maneuver here. Got about 6 to 10 inches clearance. Okay. Your
crew has moved on to some get ahead tasks, and in the process, a get ahead task to mate S5 to S4 umbilicals. This is a get ahead task to set the stage for the arrival of the S6 solar array pair scheduled for next year.
Is that the even corner?
Day 42 right here.
Yep, I see that. Okay.
44 and 46.
All right, that looks good.
I triple checked all these connections. Right now, making sure they're rotated. Here comes the outside. 43 and 45. See those?
I see them. Okay. We just now got the. Oh, okay. We were recording. I'm afraid we weren't. But, okay, I can see 43, 45. And
41, this little one right
41.
There. That's all of them.
All right, great job.
4 hours, 15 minutes into the spacewalk, this view of Rick Mastracchio on the outside of the International Space Station, clearing all of his tethers from the work area. Station Flight Control Team confirming that the two astronauts are clear of the beta gimbal assemblies of the solar arrays on the outer portion of the truss structure, that allowing the team here in Mission Control to begin tracking the sun once again with those solar rays, activating the beta gimbal assemblies and the solar alpha rotary joints.
Break here. Alpha 3, clockwise 2, set.
Tracy, we need Dave to hold off on this bolt for a second.
Stand by, Dave.
This view of Dave from Dave Williams's helmet camera looking toward the other side of the now retracted radiator on the P6 truss element at Rick Mastracchio.
You want 7/8 of a turn, huh?
Yeah, you're on H12?
Yeah.
Yes.
The shuttle and station complex traveling 215 statute miles above the Gulf of Mexico.
Rick's okay.
That's affirmative. We just need Dave to hold off until Rick is done.
Okay.
Okay. Up 3/4. Okay, there's 7/8. And it is popped up. The locking tower's popped up.
Copy that. Hey guys, take 1 second. We're passing very close to where we launched from.
Cool. Great view of it.
Can you guys see it?
Looking. Just waving at everybody. Florida. Pretty cool.
Can you guys see it? Can you make it out?
Inside the Quest airlock, Shuttle Commander Scott Kelly, along with Expedition 15 flight engineer Clay Anderson assisting Rick Mastracchio, who's climbed out of the upper portion of his spacesuit now with the cleanup activities after today's 6-hour, 17-minute spacewalk.
Der US-Raumfähre Endeavour haben ihren ersten Außeneinsatz erfolgreich beendet. Sie montierten rund 6 Stunden lang ein Verbindungsstück, ein weiteres Sonnensegel, an der Außenhaut der ISS. Heute soll der beim Start beschädigte Hitzeschild der Raumfähre mit einem Laser genauer untersucht werden. Danach will die NASA entscheiden, ob der Defekt behoben wird. Kurz nach dem Abheben hatte offenbar ein Eispartikel den Hitzeschild getroffen.
Mal wieder eine Computerpanne auf der Raumstation ISS. Nichts Dramatisches, aber leider auch gar nichts Ungewöhnliches. Michaela Schoonhöft über das neueste Abenteuer im All.
Für die Crew auf der Endeavour entwickelt sich der Einsatz zu einer echten Herausforderung. Diesmal gab es bei einer Außenmission der beiden Astronauten Mastracchio und Williams massive technische Probleme. Die beiden montierten gerade ein Verbindungsstück des Solarmoduls, als sich plötzlich ein Kontrollcomputer in der Station abschaltete. Nach Angaben der NASA sprangen zwar sofort 2 Ersatzrechner ein, doch wie es zu der Panne kam, ist unklar. Es habe zu keiner Zeit Gefahr für die Astronauten bestanden, erklärte die Raumfahrtbehörde einig. Bereits im Sommer hatte es im russischen Segment der ISS Computerprobleme gegeben. Große Sorge bereitet der amerikanischen Raumfahrtbehörde weiterhin das beschädigte Hitzeschild der Endeavour. Die NASA vermutet, dass Eis aus dem Treibstofftank einen etwa 20 Quadratzentimeter großen Spalt in die Hitzekacheln gerissen hat. Wir haben mit einer Wärmekamera 3D-Bilder aufgenommen. Darauf kann man genau erkennen, wie etwas die Kacheln trifft und ein Stück des Schaums herausgerissen wird. Beschädigte Hitzekacheln waren im Februar 2003 Ursache für das Auseinanderbrechen der Raumfähre Columbia, bei dem alle 7 Astronauten ums Leben kamen. Falls der Schaden nicht beseitigt werden kann, muss die Crew möglicherweise ein paar Monate auf der ISS ausharren, bis ein Rettungsshuttle ins All geschickt werden kann.
Ein Stück für neue Solarsegel montieren. Während der Arbeiten dann plötzlich der Schreck für die Kommandozentrale in Cape Canaveral. Der Hauptkontrollrechner der internationalen Raumstation ISS fiel aus, die Ursache ist unklar. Weil das Reservesystem sofort ansprang, konnte der Außeneinsatz trotz der Panne fortgesetzt werden. So beendeten Mastracchio und Williams ihre Arbeit nach mehr als 6,5 Stunden erfolgreich. Heute Abend wartet auf die Astronauten eine außerplanmäßige Aufgabe. Das Space Shuttle Endeavour soll auf mögliche Schäden untersucht werden. Offenbar war der Hitzeschild bereits beim Start beschädigt worden. Auf Fotos war dort eine mehr als 7 Zentimeter lange Furche zu erkennen. Es sieht so aus, dass das Loch durch ein Stück Eis verursacht wurde. Erst dachten wir, dass sich Schaumstoff gelöst hat, aber jetzt sagen uns die Radardaten, dass es Eis war. Wir werden das weiter untersuchen. Eine Reparatur der Endeavour würde einen weiteren Außeneinsatz bedeuten und womöglich die Rückkehr zur Erde verzögern. Doch die NASA will kein Risiko eingehen. Vor 4 Jahren zerbrach die Raumfähre Columbia wegen eines ähnlichen Defekts beim Wiedereintritt in die Erdatmosphäre. Zurück im Inneren der Raumstation heißt es für die Astronauten nach erfolgreicher Arbeit daher erst einmal ausruhen für die kommenden Aufgaben.
Tomorrow, which is where you put the boom on the end of the shuttle arm and go look at that area very closely with a laser that can give you a 3D picture of the damage, and then we'll run that through a thermal assessment model.
On the next job, scheduled for today, the astronauts hope to find out more information about the damage to Endeavour's heat shield.
Reißt nicht ab. Während eines mehrstündigen Außeneinsatzes fiel in der ISS der wichtigste Computer aus, glücklicherweise ohne dramatische Folgen. Nun suchen die Astronauten nach der Ursache. Stefan Landgraf über eine heikle Mission.
Was für ein Schock für die Astronauten. Der Kontrollrechner der ISS schaltete sich während des ersten Außeneinsatzes plötzlich ab. Zwar sprangen sofort 2 Ersatzcomputer ein, doch warum es zu der Panne kam, ist unklar und muss jetzt geklärt werden. Die NASA gab eilig bekannt, es habe zu keiner Zeit Gefahr für die Astronauten bestanden. Kopfzerbrechen bereitet auch immer noch der beim Start beschädigte Hitzeschild der Endeavour. Wir haben mit einer Wärmekamera 3D-Bilder aufgenommen. Darauf kann man genau erkennen, wie ein etwa grapefruitgroßes Stück Schaumstoff von der Rakete abfällt und die Raumfähre trifft. Glück im Unglück, der etwa 8 cm lange Riss liegt direkt hinter einem Querträger und ist an dieser Stelle vor extremer Hitze geschützt. Trotzdem will die NASA auf Nummer sicher gehen, denn beschädigte Hitzekacheln waren im Februar 2003 Ursache für das Auseinanderbrechen der Raumfähre Columbia, bei dem alle 7 Astronauten ums Leben kamen. Die Endeavour-Crew muss den Schaden jetzt per Roboterarm mit einem Laser genau untersuchen. Erst dann wird entschieden, wie die Mission im All weitergeht.
Auch Millionen-Dollar-Technik ist nicht vor Fehlern gefeit. Während zwei Astronauten ein tonnenschweres Verbindungsteil für neue Sonnensegel an der Raumstation ISS montierten, stürzte in der Station der Kontrollrechner ab. Sofort wurden zwei Notfallcomputer aktiviert. Den gestern entdeckten Defekt am Hitzeschild des Shuttles schätzt die NASA mittlerweile als ungefährlich ein.
Raumfahrtbehörde NASA untersucht die Schäden am Hitzeschild der Endeavour. Astronauten der internationalen Raumstation ISS überprüfen dazu die Schutzkacheln des Raumschiffs. Die Schäden waren beim Start durch herabfallende Schaumstoffteile verursacht worden.
Mit einem langen Roboterarm untersuchen die Astronauten der ISS zur Stunde die Unterseite der Raumfähre Endeavour. Eine Laserkamera am Ende des Arms sendet dreidimensionale Aufnahmen der beschädigten Hitzekacheln direkt zur NASA-Zentrale in Houston. Hier sieht man den Schaden, ein etwa apfelgroßes Loch im Hitzeschild. Beim Start hat sich ein Stück Schaumstoff gelöst, erklärt ein NASA-Vertreter. Es brach ab und traf zunächst den Tank. Von dort ist ein Teil wieder abgeprallt und hat die Raumfähre beschädigt. Wir werden das ganz genau untersuchen, bevor wir entscheiden, ob die Raumfähre repariert werden muss. Das müsste per Außeneinsatz im All geschehen. Bereits gestern hatten zwei Astronauten 6 Stunden außen an der internationalen Raumstation gearbeitet und ein tonnenschweres Verbindungsteil angeschraubt. Die Langzeitbesatzung der ISS hat derzeit Besuch von 7 Astronauten, die mit der Raumfähre Endeavour gekommen sind und gut 10 Tage bleiben sollen. Für eine sichere Rückkehr muss der Hitzeschild der Endeavour intakt sein, sonst droht ein Unglück wie 2003. Damals war die Raumfähre Columbia mit der Besatzung an Bord beim Wiedereintritt in die Erdatmosphäre verglüht.
Endeavour, and a special good morning to you today, Dave.
I will let Dave know, Shannon.
Thanks a lot.
Sure, he appreciates the song.
Yeah, we think so too.
And Houston Endeavour for inspection and PGSCs.
Go ahead.
Yeah, there's a message that references or suggests using a SpaceHab PGSC for focused inspection, and we are curious what that would be for. We think we have all the PGSCs we need.
Stand by, I'll get your answer. Denver, Houston for Scott. And good morning, Tracy. We're watching you on TV here. Yeah, it looks like the answer to your question is really to use it as a monitor, to use that A31P as a monitor. You've got to have the green jumper over an ITVC, which means you can't have it on ISS. So in step one of message 46, which is the PDRS focused inspection procedure, it has you pull up that A31P for the to get a tip elbow camera and use it as a monitor. Looking great, TC. You all did a. We didn't get a chance to really tell you how impressed we were about y'all worked together yesterday, and we had some fantastic camera views from the helmet cams, and everyone in Mission Control a few times kind of stopped and went, "Ooh, you know, it was." You guys did a great job.
Well, Steve, we really appreciate that. Thanks. And good morning to the whole Orbit One team.
Thanks.
A good view. In the Destiny Laboratory of the International Space Station, pilot Charlie Hobaugh in the foreground, Clay Anderson in the background, manning their positions at the robotics workstation, preparing to maneuver the Canadarm2 over to the starboard sill of the orbiter to grapple the 50-foot-long boom extension, the orbiter boom sensor system, which then will be handed off to the shuttle's robotic arm under the control of Tracy Caldwell and Barbara Morgan. Back on Endeavour's flight deck, Barbara Morgan and Commander Scott Kelly, as they work similar procedures as their counterparts on the station, Hobaugh and Anderson, setting up shop for the use of the shuttle's robotic arm, which will take a handoff of the orbiter boom sensor system from the Canadarm2, the station robotic arm, a short time from now. A good view from Endeavour's payload bay cameras as the boom is now well out of its moorings on the starboard sill, prepared to be maneuvered over for a handoff to the shuttle robotic arm. Again, Charlie Hobaugh, Endeavour's pilot, and Clay Anderson, the Expedition 15 flight engineer, operating the station robotic arm, Canadarm2, the shuttle robotic arm today to be maneuvered by Tracy Caldwell and Barbara Morgan with the assistance of Endeavour Commander Scott Kelly. Pilot Charlie Hobaugh maneuvering the 50-foot-long orbiter boom sensor system, presenting the open grapple fixture over to the area where the shuttle robotic arm is awaiting its arrival. The shuttle robotic arm will then affix itself. The end effector will grapple that open grapple fixture at the on the right side of your screen. And once the snares entrap themselves around the grapple fixture, then Hobaugh will release his hold on the boom, and Endeavour's astronauts will be in position to check out the systems, the flow of data, telemetry, and television through this electric flight grapple fixture prior to the start of today's inspection work. This robotics work from two arms on two different vehicles joined together, taking place as the shuttle station complex travels over Tierra del Fuego at the southern tip of South America. Endeavour's astronauts are running about 35 minutes ahead of the timeline today. As you see, Tracy Caldwell, with the assistance of Barbara Morgan, moving in over the grapple pin. The end effector, the snares in, within the end effector will grapple around that pin and latch themselves, interconnecting the electrical systems of the orbiter boom sensor system. Endeavour and the International Space Station passing over the northwest quadrant of Africa, moving from southwest to northeast at an altitude of 214 statute miles. Canadarm2 has now released the orbiter boom sensor system and is backing away. The boom in the firm grasp of the shuttle robotic arm. The Canadarm2 will be positioned to provide television support during the course of the focused inspection of Endeavour's underbelly. Although it will not reach around in of itself for any imagery, that will strictly be at the behest of the orbiter boom sensor system with its detailed imagery capability, thanks to lasers and cameras at the end of the boom. The Payload Deployment and Retrieval Systems Officer now reports that the arm is at the correct orientation for the first scan position. That will be of the thermal barrier for the main landing gear door directly underneath the belly of the orbiter itself. While the start of the focused inspection is just moments away, word coming that Fyodor Yurchikhin and Oleg Kotov in the process of installing cables in the Zvezda service module as part of the recovery of the Russian computer system and the replacement of the Bok 3 commanding unit, report finding quite a bit of condensation behind some of the panels that they're working at, and they're taking steps now to ensure that that condensate is mopped up and will not reintroduce itself to any of the new equipment that's being installed to recover the complete use of the Russian computers that failed during the STS-117 mission of Atlantis to the International Space Station back in June.
And Houston Endeavour, how do you like that view?
Endeavour Houston, nice job on the arm motion. Step 4.1, we like your picture and you go to proceed.
Okay, we'll start the recording.
The orbiter boom sensor system now in the correct position underneath the belly of Endeavour, pressing ahead with the area known as large multiple tile damage. That nomenclature is a bit deceiving. These are actually four fairly small areas of gouges and nicks. You see one of them there as the laser dynamic range imager begins to process three-dimensional imagery of one of these sites. Again, believed to have been caused by foam that struck the belly of the orbiter and may have skated up the middle of the belly during Endeavour's climb to orbit. You're looking at the coordination between the instrumentation and communications officer here in Mission Control and the crew on board Endeavour as they fine-tune the alignment of the cameras and the sensors for the orbiter boom sensor system and inspecting this area of damage on the belly of Endeavour. This is part of the resources on the orbiter boom sensor system, a digital camera that measures depth and contrast. All of this data to be poured over, analyzed, and correlated by the damage assessment team here at the Johnson Space Center of these various areas of interest. While the focused inspection continues aboard the International Space Station, Canadian Space Agency astronaut Dave Williams is working with an experiment whose principal investigator is Dr. Barry Fowler from York University in Ontario, Canada, where Williams actually earned his medical degree. This is called the PMDIS experiment, Perceptual Motor Deficits in Space, which investigates why astronauts experience difficulty with hand-eye coordination while on orbit. The expedition crew members, the long-duration crew members, have used this experiment on a regular basis as well. It's a new experiment for microgravity research. Again, its principal investigator, Dr. Barry Fowler from York University in Ontario, Canada. Williams, one of the two spacewalkers yesterday with Rick Mastracchio, who spent 6 hours 17 minutes outside the International Space Station helping to attach the starboard 5 truss segment to the starboard 4 truss segment, setting the stage for the delivery of the final set of solar arrays to the starboard side of the station in late 2008. Later today, Williams will be joining Mastracchio back in the Quest airlock in their camp out. They'll be sleeping in the airlock overnight, beginning to cleanse their bloodstreams of nitrogen to prepare for the second spacewalk of this mission tomorrow, in which they will devote the entire spacewalk to the replacement of a failed control moment gyroscope in the Z1 truss of the International Outpost. This area of tiles just aft of the large damage site is almost directly dead center on Endeavour's belly. Again, being scanned by the orbiter boom sensor system with a variety of lasers and cameras available for analysis by the imagery experts here at the Johnson Space Center. This is Mission Control Houston. The shuttle's robotic arm affixed to the 50-foot-long orbiter boom sensor system extension being maneuvered over for a handoff to the Canadarm2, the space station's robotic arm that will grapple the other grapple fixture on that boom extension and park the boom onto the starboard sill of Endeavour's payload bay. The boom's work complete for today. In a 3-hour focused inspection of areas of interest where tile damage was incurred during Endeavour's climb to orbit back on Wednesday, the mission management team will be poring over the data that will be analyzed by the damage assessment team here at the Johnson Space Center in ultimately determining the final disposition of the health of Endeavour's thermal protection shield. Good view of the orbiter boom sensor system just a few inches away from being berthed on the starboard sill of the payload bay.
Endeavour Houston, air to ground 2 for payload bay camera temperatures. You got it. Charlie and Delta, when you're done with them, as soon as you're done with them, take them off. Say again, TC.
Charlie and Delta cameras?
Yeah, it was camera Charlie and camera Delta. I think Scorch might be using Delta, but if you're done, you guys can decide that. But when you're able to, take them off.
Yeah, when he's done with it, I'll take Delta down, and then I can take Charlie down, too.
Outstanding.
Houston, Endeavor on the big loop. We're done with the release. The SRMS operator has a go for a maneuver to pre-cradle.
And Endeavor copies. Houston Endeavor for PDRS.
Go ahead.
Hey, Stevie, we are back at pre-cradle, and the arm is asleep now, and we see ourselves complete with that with focused inspection for today.
And to TC and the crew up there, this is Fergie in the Orbit 2 shift. You guys did an absolutely fantastic job today. I know it can be kind of long and harrowing, but PDRS passes along a job well done. Thanks for all your hard work.
Hey, Fergie, it's good to hear your voice. And we'd also like to pass along a thanks and kudos to the PDRS team and the photo TV team and also the imagery team who's going to take a look at all the data that we collected today. We know that you guys don't get a whole lot of time to put this stuff together, and we think everything went really well today, and you made our job really easy. So good job to all teams. Thanks a lot.
On behalf of them, I know Jill is smiling, and she sends along her appreciation. Thanks.
This is Mission Control Houston on board the International Space Station. You're looking at the station's robotic arm, Canadarm2, as it prepares to walk off of the mobile transporter. The walk-off preparing for Monday's second spacewalk to position the robotic arm in preparation for its duty on Monday to assist with the removal and replacement of a control moment gyro on the Z1 truss element.
Okay, Scott, this is Shannon here. I know folks are busy, and so if you can pass this along to Fyodor, I'd appreciate it. The MMT has decided, and it's not unexpected, this Spitz has bought you an extra 3 days, so we're officially a 14-day mission, and we will be doing O2 transfer.
Okay, copy, 14 days, and say again for the O2 transfer.
We will be doing O2 transfer, and that will be on flight day 11, and we're still working the numbers, but we expect up to about 95 pounds.
Okay, thanks. That's great news. Thank you.
This is Mission Control Houston, the shuttle and station tracking across the equator, traveling northeasterly, capturing images of Hurricane Flossie off in the distance. The hurricane tracking southeast of the Hawaiian Islands. Hurricane Flossie is packing about 135 mile per hour winds. At 5 p.m. Eastern Time, Flossie was reported to be 735 miles east-southeast of Hilo, Hawaii, and at that time was registering maximum sustained winds at approximately 135 miles per hour, gusting up to 160 miles per hour. The hurricane is traveling west at about 14 miles per hour and is expected to pass about 70 miles south of the island of Hawaii late Tuesday or early Wednesday. Forecasters expect by then that cooler waters should have weakened the storm to a Category 1 hurricane or maybe even a strong tropical storm. But the hurricane, as it's seen from this unique vantage point, 215 miles up in space, is forcing 135 mile per hour sustained winds. The Big Island of Hawaii is expected to see waves ranging from 8 to 12 feet, according to forecasters. And the surf is expected to be rising throughout the day Monday and peaking on Tuesday. Though not forecast to hit Hawaii directly, the storm is expected to pass 70 miles or so south of the island. And with the size of the storm, certainly the islands will feel some of the effects of Hurricane Flossie. The last time a hurricane hit Hawaii was back in 1992, when Hurricane Iniki caused an estimated $2.5 billion worth of damage. While the daily planning conference is ongoing, the station and shuttle crossing the Southern California coastline. Forest fires very evident from this vantage point as Endeavour and the International Space Station fly high overhead, 215 statute miles, this the Santa Barbara area just north of Los Angeles.
Weitere Tests an der Endeavour durchführen. Gestern hatten Astronauten den Hitzeschild der US-Raumfähre untersucht und eine Laserkamera lieferte dabei Bilder einer defekten Hitzekachel. Noch ist unklar, ob der Schaden repariert werden muss. Für weitere Arbeiten an der Internationalen Raumstation soll die Besatzung der Endeavour 3 Tage länger im All bleiben als geplant.
Endeavour, and a special good morning to Drew this morning.
Hey, that's like good old school 1970s jam to get you up in the morning.
I guess that's right.
While the two crews are in the early stages of this day, it's going to be a busy day and a very pivotal day for the space station as the crews work in this second spacewalk to restore the full capability of the control moment gyroscope system on the U.S. segment of the International Outpost. The control moment gyroscopes, 4 of them, are housed in the Z1 truss of the International Space Station. That truss is an exterior framework housing the gyroscopes and communications equipment. It also serves temporarily as a mounting platform for the P6 solar array truss structure that was delivered back in 2001. That P6 truss will be moved outboard on the port side of the International Space Station on the next shuttle flight in late October aboard the shuttle Discovery STS-120. This downlink television, Clay Anderson holding up a Russian pressure gauge for the camera as he works with his crewmates outside of the Quest airlock. You can see part of the extravehicular mobility units, the upper torso of those units, the U.S. spacesuits that Rick Mastracchio and Dave Williams will be wearing as they move out into the void of space outside of Quest for their second spacewalk of the mission. In the background, you can see Mastracchio and Williams as they begin preparations. Just coming in to the field of view, Scott Kelly, Endeavour's commander, is presiding over the suit-up procedures. He will be then handing over the chores of the choreography of the spacewalk to mission specialist Tracy Caldwell once the crew has depressurized the outer most compartment of the two-compartment Quest airlock, the crew lock, whose hatch will be closed after the crew has suited up and conducted all of their suit and communications checks with ground controllers here in Houston. Astronauts Dave Williams on the left and Rick Mastracchio on the right check out their suit systems and their biomedical data along with the start of communications checks with flight controllers here in Houston. Preparations moving ahead on schedule for the start of the second spacewalk of the mission less than 3 hours from now.
Nice, everybody.
Mastracchio and Williams have donned their liquid cooling garments. They'll be moving into their bulky extravehicular mobility units a short time from now, working with the assistance of Commander Scott Kelly on the lower left-hand portion of your screen, just out of the field of view. Endeavour's commander in charge of the suit-up procedures, joined by Expedition 15 flight engineer Clay Anderson.
Airlock Houston on Space Ground 2. We got good EMU data. We'll take the comm mode to hardline, and then you can pick up in step 16 and press.
Okay, copy that. Thanks.
Expedition 15 flight engineer Clay Anderson continuing to work as well as he assists Rick Mastracchio with some of the equipment, currently securing the lower portion of his torso for the extravehicular mobility unit, putting on the space shoes that are part of those bulky suits.
Houston Endeavour on air ground two for transfer.
Go ahead, Alan.
I just wanted to see if I could get a quick reminder on, there's one of the launch pads we have, which launched at location in SpaceHab Alpha Sierra 01, and we're starting to load that bag back up, but there's a lot of foam in there as well, packing foam. Just want to know if they had any ideas for the disposition of that foam. I just can't remember what we were going to do with it.
Understand the question. We'll find out.
Endeavour Houston on air to ground 2 for TC. Yeah, TC, we're going to add a request into the for you to record some data for us in the middle of the EVA. And I've got a page number and a reference, and I can give all that to you. But the short version is we would like you to record the release torques for the failed CMG. And if you want, I'll give you the page number and the step number so you can annotate all that whenever it's a good time.
Copy. With the purging of the two extravehicular mobility units now complete, the Quest airlock will be repressurized. It currently sits at 10.4 pounds per square inch of pressure, will be repressurized about 4 additional pounds per square inch to its normal levels. And soon, Dave Williams and Rick Mastracchio will be moving into the crew lock, the outermost compartment of the two-compartment Quest airlock, for final suit checks and preparations prior to the closure of the hatch to the crew lock to isolate the two spacewalkers for the final depressurization prior to the start of today's spacewalk. Dave Williams with a firm grasp on one of the pistol grip tools, the power drills, if you will, that he will be using to unbolt a number of bolts and fasteners holding the control moment gyroscope in its housing in the Z1 truss of the International Space Station. It will also be used to help remove the new control moment gyroscope from a spare parts platform at the rear of Endeavour's cargo bay.
Yeah, hey, we just finished the transfer of the Speedus into Melfi. And we're done with Merlin. We're ready to transition it to cold drink ops. Hey, that was just a joke for our payload folks. Hey, do you want me to work the warm shutdown on it, or do you want to just we leave it running?
Actually, we definitely appreciated that. Houston's supposed to be 103 today, so cold drink ops are definitely in order. But in the meantime, you got to go into Merlin warm shutdown.
103. Ouch. Is that the what it feels like temp or the real temp?
No, that's the real temp. We're all going to be wearing EMUs when we walk out to our cars here today.
That's blazing. Okay, we'll put Merlin warm shutdown and work.
Thanks.
Here's Al with the OCA stuff.
And Houston, just FYI, Clay is replacing a helmet light on EB2, the bulb.
Okay, Houston, copy, stand by.
Okay, Dave, you got to go to open and stow the hatch. Let me know when that at least it's open, and I'll take the emergency MPEV valve closed.
Okay, sounds good.
Endeavour Commander Scott Kelly will be handing off the choreography of today's spacewalk to Tracy Caldwell a short time from now as the outer thermal cover pops open. As the shuttle station complex travels over China, at an altitude of 214 statute miles, moving from northwest to southeast, soon to cross the equator.
The hatch is open, thermal cover is open.
Hey guys. Well, as long as you're happy with your initial tether configs, I heard them earlier, you're good to go.
Okay.
Set the hatch open. Come on out, Dave.
All right, I copy that. And Rick, do you show me in good configs?
Canadian Space Agency astronaut Dave Williams, the third Canadian to walk in space, emerging from the Quest airlock. And Rick Mastracchio now moving out of Quest, wearing the suit bearing the red stripes, EV1, extravehicular crew member number one. Dave Williams is EV2, wearing the pure white suit. As Dave Williams installs the portable foot restraint at the end of Canadarm 2, you're looking from the helmet camera view from Rick Mastracchio as he peels back the thermal shroud covering the failed control moment gyroscope in its housing in the Z1 truss. This is the gyro that will be removed and replaced with a new one that is sitting in a spare parts platform at the rear of Endeavour's cargo bay at the moment. A good view of the two spacewalkers. This from a camera on the port one truss of the International Space Station. Dave Williams is in the lower of the two spacewalkers positions, Rick Mastracchio at the top. Mastracchio continues to survey the work site where the failed control moment gyroscope is located. Dave Williams is in the process of hooking up a bracket upon which the failed CMG will be mounted once it's removed from its slot.
Copy, J6. It's disconnected. Looks clean.
Okay, we have you tucking that behind the handrail on CMG4.
All four power connectors have now been demated from the failed CMG.
Okay, yeah, they're just tucked behind cable trays, and they look like they're out of the way.
Okay, and you used your ret?
Copy.
Okay, copy.
And TCA also have a rest going from that same handrail to the ball sack itself.
Bolt.
Yeah. Be the last, that's the last, dude.
Okay, bolt 6 will be the last.
Okay, copy that.
Okay, 9 to 13 turns.
Okay, turning.
Again, Rick.
I'm up bolt 4. Pretty good running torque now. It's lightening up. About 9 turns on bolt 4, Trace.
Copy 9 on 4.
10 turns on bolt 5, and that was 4.2 pounds for running torque.
10 and 4.2 on 5.
Turns for me, 3.8 foot pounds.
Copy 9 on 1, 10 on 3.
Good copy.
Okay, hold on that last one, Dave.
Okay, I'm holding.
Right now, I see more of Rick right now, and looks real clear.
After that, take your
Rick Mastracchio with a firm grasp on the 600-pound control moment gyroscope. The failed gyro having been removed from its slot in the Z1 truss of the International Space Station.
Rick, do you see the mutt?
Mastracchio will hand the CMG off to Dave Williams to be temporarily stowed on this bracket known as a ball stack that has been set up on a handrail on the Z1 itself.
In position. There, you got it. I'm going to, you can send it a little more zenith just so I make sure I don't bump my head on it when I come back up here.
And watch the top of your head, Dave, with the torquer.
Yeah, he's clear. Okay, how's this, Rick?
That's pretty good, Dave.
Okay, let me just tighten it in that position.
I just got to remember not to bump it.
The two spacewalkers, Rick Mastracchio and Dave Williams, have now temporarily stowed the control moment gyroscope on the bracket or ball stack that is affixed to a handrail on the Z1 truss.
Okay with you.
That's all right. I think, are you taking the camera with you, too?
Yes, and I'll get to the camera in a bit.
Once the crew members retrieve additional tethers and tools from the Quest airlock, Dave Williams will plant his feet into a portable foot restraint at the end of the Canadarm2 for a ride down into the payload bay of Endeavour.
Black on the, I show my temperature in a good config, and I think I'm ready to move to the payload bay.
Okay, I'm ready.
Hey, David, so you got the ingress aid in your lap, and if you're ready, I'll give the Canadian man a ride on the Canadian arm.
Geez, thanks. Looking forward to riding after all this walking.
Mastracchio on the right with the red stripes on his suit, and Williams on the left, peeling back the layers of insulation that encapsulated the brand new control moment gyroscope at the rear of Endeavour's cargo bay. Canadian Space Agency astronaut Dave Williams about to re-enter the foot restraint at the end of the Canadarm2 as he and Rick Mastracchio have been working to remove shroud straps and insulation around this new control moment gyroscope that soon will be in the hands of Williams to bring up to a temporary work site on the external stowage platform number 2 that is attached to the Quest airlock of the International Space Station.
Dave, I'm waiting on your call.
Okay, and let me come down, get a hand on it. Okay, I have both heels locked in place. My mini workstation end effector is locked. Got a red on it, and I've got two hands on it.
First 10 turn.
Yeah, it felt like it's come loose.
Sure has. Sure has. Up about a foot right now. Give me 1 second, Dave.
Okay, no problem.
Trying not to bump it on you.
Okay.
Okay, Dave. Yeah, you got a roll on it.
Which way?
Push your right arm down. Fill your left arm up a little bit. You got good clearance to the ATA next to it, or the LRU next to it, I should say. So I think you're clear to go straight up.
Okay.
Maybe lean a little to your right, Dave, or slide a little to your right if you can. That's good.
Okay, Scorch, you got to go.
Okay, we're ready, Dave. Hang on tight. All right, good clearance, looking good.
Rick, look to the right at his safety tether, it's all clear.
My safety tether's clear, yes.
I'm talking about Dave.
It's not connected to structure, so yes. All right, you're well clear of everything.
Thanks, man.
How's the ride, Dave, and the stability of that big boy?
Great. Got a lot of mass.
So this is not a jettison mission, okay?
Copy.
Everything looks good. Okay. Done. Putting on little booties. And I got some TA clamps to clean up here. Do a few to get some slack.
A panoramic view of Dave Williams as he is being maneuvered by Charlie Hobaugh and Clay Anderson on the Canadarm2, the station shuttle complex flying over the South Pacific Ocean, about to move from southwest to northeast on a course that will take it across the west coast of South America and the equator a short time from now.
All right.
Mr.
reminder, be careful of the OBSS as you make your way in there.
Got about another minute and a half.
Copy.
Once we stop, we'll set you up to go into the ESP2.
Copy.
Okay, then go ahead and mate it to the receptacle on the Kiyoko assembly and wind it up as best you can so Barb doesn't have any snags when she pulls that out.
Okay, this move's fading out on you, Dave.
Okay.
A panoramic view from Endeavour's payload bay cameras looking up at the International Space Station as Rick Mastracchio continues to work in the payload bay to reconfigure power cables for external stowage platform number 3, basically disconnecting that spare parts platform from orbiter power in preparation for its being lifted out of the payload bay by robotic arm operator Barbara Morgan tomorrow for a handoff to the station robotic arm to be installed on the P3 or Port 3 truss of the International Space Station.
We're moving, Dave.
Copy.
Hey, Rick, we can hear you in the lab. You're doing great work.
Really?
Trying to be careful.
It's great. We've got video with sound effects.
Lead spacewalker Rick Mastracchio working at the interface between the orbiter docking system and pressurized mating adapter number 2, the docking interface linking the shuttle and station together as the two craft move out over the Atlantic Ocean off the north coast of South America, moving from southwest to northeast at an altitude of 214 statute miles, 2 hours, 34 minutes into the spacewalk. Mastracchio has adjusted tethers and is now making his way up to join Dave Williams at the external stowage platform number 2 that is affixed to the Quest airlock, where they will soft dock the new control moment gyroscope and its flight support equipment in the first step towards removing that new CMG for its installation into the Z1 truss.
Good question.
546? Yeah, it's 0546, and I'll let Jackie and Paul tell me if that's not where they want it.
Think that'll work.
Okay, we're not good to go.
Hey, Rick, while you're getting yourself set up, I'll just remind you to keep your safety tether clear of the work site.
Copy, Trish.
Get up.
Yeah, a little more. Can you?
Yeah.
And nice and easy. Right about there, stop.
Okay.
Now I need to go towards your feet. About a foot and a half. Let's pitch it down. Now start pushing down. Easy, easy. Do a little clock, counterclockwise, a little more counterclockwise. Just about there. Can you pitch it, let's see, can you drive Dave into structure a little bit, George?
Absolutely.
Because it's mostly down.
Dave, when he moves, keep it steady.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, great. A little bit of resistance from the Fram plug or whatever, connector. Okay, now push it down. A little more counterclockwise. There we go.
It felt good.
Yep. All right.
Yeah, I'm holding it.
Seems to be fairly stable. Soft docked, I hope.
Dave, do you need to come down to hold it in?
Maybe 2 inches max.
I'll give you a little bit.
Okay, you can stop there, Squirch.
Hold your ears.
And GCA complete. Turning.
Look at your axles.
The new control moment gyroscope and its flight support equipment are now installed and hard mounted on the external stowage platform number 2 on the Quest airlock. The next step is to remove the CMG from the flight support equipment and to maneuver that up to the Z1 truss for its installation. Once the new CMG is installed and bolted into place and ground straps are attached, then it will be up to the ground controllers to activate the new CMG and to begin checking out its systems and spinning it up so it can be placed online to join the other 3 control moment gyroscopes and restore full functionality of the orientation control system for the U.S. segment of the International Space Station for the first time since October 2006. Dave Williams has handed off the new control moment gyroscope to Rick Mastracchio at the Z1 truss so that he can begin work to carefully ease the new component into its slot, joining 3 other control moment gyroscopes.
Is that it in the soft dock?
Well, not much of a soft dock, but it's in.
Okay.
The helmet camera of Rick Mastracchio showing the control moment gyroscope, a soft dock in its slot at the Z1 truss. Now beginning work with the pistol grip tool to drive bolts that will hard mate the component into its new location.
Okay, Tracy, we'd like the electrical connectors if you can and an overall survey, and that'd be great.
Good job, man.
Hey, Rick, if you could, we got a good view looking at the J1, 2, and 3 connectors, if you could get, go down and give us a little bit better view.
How's that?
I like it.
J1,
Shannon? I don't know if you got KU, but...
We do have KU, and that looks great. Thanks.
Okay. I'm going to hold
all
here.
Yours.
Yeah, I'm just going to hold right here. Well, let me lean back a little, I guess, huh? You're going to need some room.
Your red on it?
Yep.
Okay, stand by one. I'm just going to relocate mine. Okay.
Okay.
Rick, you going to be able to reach that?
Nope. Dave's going to take it.
I will.
Okay. Hold on. There you go. Just take it with you.
Okay.
Okay.
Senator Houston, Big Loop, just so you know, we've checked the connectivity on the new CMG and it all checked out good.
All right. That's great news. Thanks, Sam.
Beautiful. Hey, great news. Thanks, Hannah.
Hey, you guys rock. Good job.
Way to go, boys.
Thanks. Thanks very much.
The transparent number 18 in the bottom right corner of this view indicates this is the helmet camera of Dave Williams. As he continues with securing of the 600-pound mass CMG to its flight support equipment.
Half turn, 25.3 foot-pounds, looks like.
Okay, that was bolt one?
Yep.
10.5, 25.3. And did you finish, I'm sorry, were you doing, was
yeah,
that the bolt
just,
you were
I
doing?
I just finished bolt five, yes, no.
Okay.
And, DC, bolt four, green light. 25.6, 8 turns.
Bolt 4, 8 turns, 25.6 with a torque copy.
Good copy.
And I think I'm clear of everything. TCU, great.
I don't have a real good visual on you.
Okay. Where'd you get the ingress? Speed up out of the way. Okay. Good motion.
Copy, thanks.
Dave, I'm looking through your helmet cam and it's a mighty fine MLI.
Okay, well, that's good. I'm glad you like it.
Today's second of four planned spacewalks during the mission lasted 6 hours 28 minutes. It began at 10:32 Monday morning Central Time and ended at straight up 5 p.m. 2 days from now, on Wednesday, the third spacewalk will include Rick Mastracchio once again, but instead of Dave Williams, Clay Anderson in the green shirt here will be performing the third and fourth spacewalks. He will join Mastracchio on that third spacewalk. Mission specialist Tracy Caldwell, who is joining Clay Anderson and Scott Kelly in the airlock quest. She oversaw the spacewalk from inside, serving as the in-cabin choreographer. We're back here in Mission Control just in time to capture the nightly pass high over Hurricane Flossie, the storm nearing Hawaii, the south of Hawaii. The shuttle and station complex has just crossed the equator on a northeasterly track. At 5 p.m. Eastern Time, Flossie was positioned about 425 miles southeast of the Hawaiian island of Hilo.
30, we'll get that answer to you later tonight or tomorrow.
The storm was forecast to be moving west-northwest at about 15 miles per hour, and it's still a Category 3 storm with maximum sustained winds of 126 miles per hour. It's expected to pass by the Hawaiian Islands and generate some fairly significant surf, but not expected right now to actually hit the islands. This view captured from one of the several cameras on the exterior of the International Space Station.
Endeavour and station on the big loop for big picture words.
Okay, go ahead.
I want to give you some big picture words. The bottom line is no decision's been made to either repair or not repair. We're hoping to clear this by analysis. That obviously is very complicated, but we're working on that. If we can't clear it, there are several options. Overlay is off the table. The options, the methods we're looking at are emittance wash coupled with TRAD. None of this will occur before EVA 4, and that's currently scheduled on flight date 10, so we wouldn't be doing any of this earlier than flight date 10. EVA 3 right now will go as planned. And a note from Steve Lindsay is going to follow, and as soon as we get that, we'll send it up to you.
Okay. Yeah, we've been talking this a little bit, and we'd like the no overlay plan. And, again, you know, you guys got all the data, so, you know, we appreciate some preliminary words, but understand it takes a while to sort this kind of these issues out. So we'll talk to you tomorrow about it, I guess.
Okay, Endeavour and station, copy that. And we're going to send you guys up a movie, a little animation, also the MMT summary, and anything else we get overnight, we'll be there in the morning for you.
Okay, thanks.
Endeavour, and a special good morning to Tracy, and happy birthday, Tracy.
Well, and good morning to you, Sam, and the whole Orbit 3, and thank you very much. This is one of the best places I could think of to spend my birthday, and it certainly tops last year at Minute Maid Park. Just want to thank my whole family and all of my friends for all of their kind words and good wishes and all their great support. Looking forward to today.
As you watched Dave Williams in the Destiny Laboratory of the International Space Station recording data from some of the work that he's been doing on board, Barbara Morgan is about to put the shuttle's robotic arm in motion, moving it down towards the rear of Endeavour's cargo bay for a grapple of the external stowage platform. You now see the Canadian-built shuttle robotic arm moving in position. The platform is at the very rear of the cargo bay, up against the aft bulkhead of the cargo bay. The box-like device that you see in the middle that the arm is moving directly over, that's the nitrogen tank assembly. One of the three components, the nitrogen tank assembly, is a spare part for one of two installed such tank assemblies that currently reside on the starboard one and port one truss, providing a back pressure for ammonia in the external thermal control system lines. A good view from the camera at the rear of Endeavour's cargo bay, showing the shuttle's robotic arm under the control of mission specialist Barbara Morgan, heading in for a grapple on the 7,000-pound external stowage platform. Looking from the end effector camera on the shuttle's robotic arm, a good view of one of two grapple fixtures on external stowage platform number 3.
Houston Endeavour on the big loop for ESP3.
Go ahead.
Stevie, just getting you caught up with where we are. We have now grappled to ESP3. We are at finishing up step 2, and we're moving on to step 1 of the Ember.
We copy, and we're with you. We watched that grapple on the big screen here in Mission Control. Congratulations, Barbara.
She says thanks.
Al Drew, now in the Destiny Laboratory, hauling cargo from the SpaceHab module in Endeavour's cargo bay into the International Space Station. Cargo operations continue ahead of schedule. Charlie Hobaugh, Endeavour's pilot, who is also in Destiny, you see in the floorboards right now, will be operating the station robotic arm to take the handoff along with Clay Anderson. He is also working to help Drew at the moment with some of the cargo transfer and stowage work.
Houston Endeavour on the big loop for ESP3. We are putting the arm in motion, maneuvering to Lohar.
And copy, Tracy, and we're watching.
And the Payload Deployment and Retrieval Systems Officer in Mission Control reports that the external stowage platform is in the process of being unberthed. Very slowly, very surely, with kid gloves, Barbara Morgan will be lifting the 3.5-ton spare parts platform directly above the payload bay to what is known as a low hover position, clearing it of any orbiter structure, prior to maneuvering it for a handoff to the station robotic arm. With a deft touch, Barbara Morgan continues to raise the external stowage platform out of the cargo bay of Endeavour, now having cleared the neighborhood of the orbiter boom sensor system.
Houston Endeavour on the big loop for ESP3. We are at low hover position, setting up for the maneuver to port.
Copy at low hover, and we had a good view of that from the A camera.
In the equipment lock section of the Quest airlock, Rick Mastracchio and Dave Williams are working with the U.S. extravehicular mobility units, configuring tools and recharging batteries for the third spacewalk of the mission that will be conducted tomorrow by Mastracchio and Expedition 15 flight engineer Clay Anderson. Having reached the low hover position, Morgan now will press ahead and continue to maneuver the external spare parts platform over for a handoff to the station's robotic arm. Payload Deployment and Retrieval Systems Officer reports that the arm is in motion once again as Endeavour and the International Space Station pass out over the northern coast of Africa, beyond the Sahara Desert, and over the Mediterranean. With a set of space station solar arrays gleaming as the shuttle station complex flies over the northern Saudi Peninsula. Barbara Morgan continues to maneuver the external stowage platform, the 3.5-ton spare parts platform, over for the handoff soon to the station robotic arm that will be under the control of Charlie Hobaugh and Clay Anderson.
Houston Endeavour on the big loop, setting the arm in motion to handoff position.
Copy, Tracy. Thanks for the updates. Endeavour Houston, air to ground 202 tank P message coming up in just about 2 minutes, and that'll be heater off.
Copy.
That's in the big loop. We're going in for grapple again.
Okay, on the big loop, we copy and we're ready for the grapple.
This is Mission Control Houston.
Now that's a million dollars.
Flight engineer Clay Anderson now beginning to move the Canadarm2 in to grapple the other grapple fixture on external stowage platform number 3. Barbara Morgan holding it rock steady as Anderson waits for the appropriate moment to ensnare the end effector of the big arm, as it is known, Canadarm2, around the other grapple fixture for the handoff of this 3.5-ton spare parts platform.
Houston Endeavour on the big loop. We have grapple. The SRMS is go for release.
Houston copies. That means Endeavour for the PDRS folks. You have to go to pick up and ESP 3 on grapple. Pick up at step 2 on page 2-13.
We're there.
Work is in progress to ungrapple the shuttle's robotic arm from the external stowage platform now that it's in the grasp of the station robotic arm. Clay Anderson and Charlie Hobaugh have been sharing duties today at the robotics workstation in the Destiny Laboratory and will soon begin to maneuver the 3.5-ton spare parts platform over to the port 3 truss of the station for its installation and bolting into place automatically to a unpressurized cargo carrier attachment system. Clay Anderson and Charlie Hobaugh, operating from the robotics workstation in the Destiny Laboratory, will use a camera system called the External Berthing Camera System, or EBCS, to provide them with visual cues that will be sufficient to enable the robotic arm operators to precisely align the capture mechanism on the external stowage platform with the capture latch assembly or the claw on the truss itself.
And Tracy and Barb, we copy. Good work. We think it was pretty considerate of you to hand a big birthday present over to the space station on this day.
Well, Stevie, we were happy to get rid of that from the payload bay and hand it over to the station. It was not an easy maneuver, especially winging it over the port side like that, and I think Barb did an absolutely fantastic job.
We all concur, and you folks make a good team. Good work all around.
Thanks, Stevie. You guys are a part of that, too, so we appreciate your help.
This view in the Quest airlock showing Anderson on the top of your screen, Dave Williams with his back to the screen, and Rick Mastracchio on the right as they prepare equipment to be used tomorrow for the third spacewalk by Mastracchio and Anderson. The 3.5-ton external stowage platform actually weighs more than the starboard 5 truss that was installed on the International Space Station back on Saturday during the first spacewalk by Rick Mastracchio and Dave Williams. Pilot Charlie Hobaugh being very, very methodical as he glacially maneuvers this large structure that resembles a giant waffle over to the Port 3 truss for its installation onto this capture latch device at the zenith or top side of the truss. The mechanical systems officer in the space station flight control room reports three ready-to-latch indications in the final stages of ESP-3 installation.
And Houston, we'd like you to go to LMP SSRMS.
We are go for the SSRMS to be LMP.
Okay, thank you. And Houston, we're going to put step 11 in work of UCAS normal mate.
You go for step 11, we see the arm limped.
A good view of Tracy Caldwell in the Destiny Laboratory of the International Space Station, along with other crew members, Barbara Morgan, along with Commander Scott Kelly, Charlie Hobaugh, still at the controls of the Canadarm2 at the robotics workstation as he is wrapping up work, limping the station's robotic arm as the external stowage platform is in the process of being hard-mated or captured by the capture latch assembly claw on the Port 3 truss of the International Space Station. And in the station flight control room, the mechanical systems officer now confirms that the external stowage platform has been firmly captured to the P3 truss of the International Space Station. It is now hard-mated, and the green light will be given momentarily for pilot Charlie Hobaugh to ungrapple ESP-3. It is now a permanent fixture on the International Space Station at 11:18 a.m. Central Time.
We have the spouses and family members representing just about every member of the crew just to my left here. And the spouses from every family have contributed to bringing lunch for the two shuttle and ISS control teams here today. So basically, lunch is on you guys, and we want to thank you and get a lot of smiles going on down here in the room from your families.
Oh, that's mighty nice of us. You're welcome.
Thanks a lot.
No, we really appreciate them doing that for you guys, and that's really great. Thank you.
I think they're setting the bar very, very high here, so we'll look forward to every mission after this.
And Houston, if you want to come on board the flight deck, you're welcome.
And Scott, Erdogan 2, we see on the flight deck, and we'll see if we can get this routed back to where the spouses are now over in the back room. Gosh, I don't think we've seen Mastracchio without a spacesuit on the whole mission. You look great, Rick. The families that are here today are gathered around the TV in the ISS control room watching the downlink of you. Oh, you folks look great, and I think your floating images are being enjoyed a lot by the families.
The spouses and families of Endeavour's crew who visited the Space Shuttle Flight Control Room a moment or two ago are now in the Space Station Flight Control Room enjoying the view of their loved ones as one by one they appear up on the flight deck to say hello.
Momente, da hätte ich manche Lehrer auf den Mond schießen können. Doch jetzt geben die Lehrer schon Unterricht aus dem All und die Schüler freut's. Die NASA-Astronautin Barbara Morgan machte heute die internationale Raumfähre ISS zum fliegenden Klassenzimmer. So viele aufmerksame Schüler hatte sie wahrscheinlich noch nie.
Stark wie Pippi Langstrumpf, so beeindruckt man als Lehrerin die Schüler wirklich. Barbara Morgan gibt alles als Pauker aus dem All. Rund 350 Kilometer von der ISS entfernt, tief unten in Idaho, staunen ihre Schüler vor dem Bildschirm nicht schlecht. Was ist eigentlich der Unterschied zwischen einem Lehrer und einem Astronauten, fragt ein Mädchen per Funk ins fliegende Klassenzimmer. Astronauten und Lehrer tun eigentlich dasselbe. Wir forschen, wir entdecken und wir geben das anderen weiter, sagt Frau Lehrerin aus dem All zurück. Wenn's doch immer so wäre im drögen Schulalltag, aber schwerelos kann Physikunterricht eben nur aus dem Weltraum sein. Das war spannend, ein echter Nervenkitzel. Die Schüler sind begeistert und die NASA auch. Für uns ist es wichtig, die Schüler mit dem Thema Weltall vertraut zu machen. Wir brauchen dringend Nachwuchs für unsere kommenden Mondflüge. Die anderen Lehrer in Idaho werden es nach diesem Unterricht aus der ISS schwer haben, denn die Schulstunde aus dem All war einfach überirdisch.
Nationalen Raumstation ISS, die Fragen von Kindern aus ihrem Heimatstaat Idaho beantwortet. Die Schüler wollten von der Ex-Lehrerin unter anderem wissen, wie man in der Schwerelosigkeit trinkt. Und so antwortete sie auf die Frage nach ihrem Fitnessprogramm.
Endeavor. For Barbara, you should recognize the artist that song is none other than Adam.
Good morning, Fergie. What a wonderful way to wake up. Thank you to my family and special thanks to Adam for the beautiful song.
And now our first view in the Quest airlock this morning as Commander Scott Kelly on the left and Mission Specialist Dave Williams, the Canadian Space Agency astronaut who conducted the first two spacewalks of the mission with Rick Mastracchio on the right, are working with the today's crew members. You see Clay Anderson with the mask on, continuing to pre-breathe pure oxygen to complete the process of cleansing nitrogen out of his bloodstream. He's on the left-hand side of the picture of Rick Mastracchio. He'll be donning the extravehicular mobility unit or spacesuit that you see on the right side of your picture.
And Houston, for the O2 pressure, same issue again as the other day. The gauge is slightly into the yellow region.
And airlock Houston on Space Ground 2, we copy in.
In the Quest airlock are two spacewalkers for today. They are in the final process of being helped into their extravehicular mobility units by Endeavour Commander Scott Kelly, who's working with Mastracchio to put his gloves on at the moment. Just out of the field of view at the bottom of your screen, Canadian Space Agency astronaut Dave Williams working with Clay Anderson. Mastracchio and Anderson spent the night in the Quest airlock in the camp-out procedures that purge nitrogen from their bloodstreams. And will continue the process of pre-breathing pure oxygen once they put their helmets on a short time from now.
Okay, you take your purge valves closed and O2 actuators to IV. And on the big loop, we're going to repress the airlock. You might get a master alarm on the shuttle. to repress the airlock.
Okay, Scott, we are go for you to repress the airlock.
All dressed up, ready to go, perhaps a bit earlier than planned. Rick Mastracchio, the lead spacewalker for this mission, EV1 today, as he was back on Saturday and again on Monday. Kelly and Williams helping Mastracchio and Clay Anderson suit up for today's planned 6.5-hour spacewalk to reposition communications equipment and crew equipment carts on the truss portion of the International Space Station, also to retrieve experiments and to essentially to prepare the P6 truss structure for its relocation outboard to the far end of the port side of the station's truss in October during the next shuttle mission. Now in the Quest airlock, intravehicular crew member Tracy Caldwell providing high fives for the two spacewalkers as they prepare to be disengaged from the sidewalls of the equipment lock to be moved into the crew lock, where Caldwell and Scott Kelly will position them appropriately before closing the hatch, setting the stage for the start of the depressurization of that outermost compartment prior to the beginning of today's spacewalk. In support of the spacewalk operations, Hobaugh will be joined by cosmonaut Oleg Kotov at the robotics workstation in the Destiny Laboratory as they move Rick Mastracchio and Clay Anderson about to various areas of the truss system of the International Space Station in removing communications gear and relocating crew equipment translation carts that are part of the rail system.
Copy, and we're watching.
Barbara Borgen now maneuvering the shuttle's robotic arm. You can see it in motion, moving it toward the appropriate viewing position to provide situational awareness and television views of the work that Rick Mastracchio and Clay Anderson will be conducting to remove the S-band antenna assembly from the P6 truss and to move it over to the Port 1 truss, where it will be permanently installed.
I'm going to pass that bag out. I got a ret ready to go. Okay. Nice and easy. Okay, you going to leave the large small in there? Or we'll bring it with us. Okay, let's see here. Figure out the best place to attach to. ERT2. Now I'm just going to. All right, Clay. All right, here we go. Hold on 1 second. Okay,
here you go. From Rick Mastracchio's helmet camera, good view as Clay Anderson emerges to begin the second spacewalk of his career.
Rick, you're putting on the whip adapter now.
I got the APFR on my BRT. I'm going to go for the whip adapter.
Anderson currently working with one of the crew equipment translation carts, placing it in an interim configuration prior to the task later today to disengage both carts and manually carry them from the port side of the truss of the International Space Station over to the starboard truss.
Got about a half a meter to go.
Stop there.
Okay, we'll hold here.
Okay, Okay, Tracy, I've got Fox.
Great view of Rick Mastracchio planting his feet in the portable foot restraint at the end of the Canadarm2 being operated by Charlie Hobaugh from the Destiny Laboratories robotic workstation. ...214 miles over the South Pacific, approaching the west coast of South America. Rick Mastracchio, at the end of the station's robotic arm, takes a ride to the P6 solar array truss structure.
Emperor Join Oak Castle, will be just a second.
Copy.
Okay, your heels look good.
Okay, I agree. Hope I'm at a good distance to do all this.
Houston, as we talked earlier, I understand your go for course on this maneuver.
Hey, just a reminder of the SAS and no touch areas, the low and high gain antennas, and the Z93 thermal paint.
Copy.
Basically everywhere you want to grab.
Yep. I understand. No problem. I could see SASA now.
You like the load?
Yes, we do. And just so you know, we've got really bad calm on round two, so we're probably going to have to stop on the big loop mostly.
Okay, that's what I'm on. Rick, you're going for a ride. Here we go.
Ready. Oh, now I can feel that.
Breathtaking views of Rick Mastracchio at the end of the Canadarm2, the station robotic arm, as... pilot Charlie Hobaugh, working in the Destiny Laboratory along with Russian cosmonaut Oleg Kotov, moves the moves Mastracchio to the P6 truss where he will set up shop.
Take it. All right. Let's see. Probably what I need to do is if I can go body forward, just maybe. Well, hold on. Let me.
A view from the top as Rick Mastracchio at the end of the Canadarm2 reaches the. S-band antenna subassembly on the P6 truss. In the upper left-hand portion of your screen, you can see the canister, the mast canister for the P6 truss. This is where the two sets of solar arrays are now folded and locked in place in their respective mast canisters.
I'll get back in.
Don't forget that camera.
No, I'm going to leave it on the set.
Mastracchio on the top left of your picture, continuing to complete the work with the S-band antenna that will upgrade the S-band communication system in its new location.
play. You got these CETA cards all ready to go, huh?
Yes, sir.
Good job, man. Hey, Clay, look at me for a second here. And you're kind of weird. Your right helmet light, you got both lights on.
Yeah.
Both of them?
Yeah, I didn't think that was possible.
Didn't either.
Now you got one. Now it's back to normal.
Would you like us to line up the CETA card, or are you going to move the arm, Scorch?
If you give me vectors, we can get there.
I would just move left. Oh, good. 1 or 2 meters.
I'll tell you what, I'm going to buy a valve. I'm going to move you in, and we can move the CETA carts to get you in. I think it'd probably be easier.
It's easy to move them.
It is.
Hey, Scorch, do you have a good
really.
Okay, I'm going to move you into structure now, Rick.
Sounds good.
Scorch, you have a good view of your elbow?
Clay, turn around.
You see a comment?
Is that in order?
No, it's just
yeah,
kind of.
Good 3 or 4 feet to go, Scorch. Hey there.
I said there was an order from your commander. I'm just the messenger.
Okay, Tracy, my left leg tether's locked black on black to the Irkham, so I'm good on the arms tether, and I'm going to pass my safety tether to Rick.
Copy. I got a good view of you out the overhead.
Did you get your hand on it?
Oh. Yeah, hold on. You could undo it now.
All right, Clay, I'm going to stay on this over here on the outboard side. Get ready for this.
This is Mission Control Houston, an outstanding view as the shuttle station complex tracks from southwest to northeast, approaching the west coast of South America. Clay Anderson on the left, Rick Mastracchio on the right, as they continue to deploy brake handles, stow swing arms, and position other equipment for the relocation of crew equipment translation aid carts, a pair of these rail carts that ride on the rail system of the truss of the International Space Station to transport equipment and spacewalkers for assembly work.
Let me put my grabber daddy on the... released. You've got it, Clay.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Just pitch up just at the end. That's a little, that's good right there. Just hold that position. You're clear.
I've got it.
Clay, if you got everything clear and you got a good hold on it, I'll start backing you up.
Yeah, Rick. I want Scorch, I need Rick to go inboard a little bit more to clear the handle.
Yep. Okay, I see him clear that hand.
I'm clear now. Okay, Scorch, I'm ready to rock and roll.
There you go.
Got the message, Trey.
Copy. Houston, you copy. He's got the message on this PGT.
And Houston, EB3, there's no jettison today, correct? No jettison today, Clay.
You look good, man. Look stable. And clearance.
Hey, there's a nice ESP3 that somebody put up on the station yesterday. It looks great, Scorch.
Wow.
How you doing over there, Clay?
Just fine.
Enjoying the view. It's magnificent.
You guys might be able to, especially Rick, might be able to see Tropical Storm Aaron, which is formed in the Gulf of Mexico.
We'll take a look.
Oleg was just saying to make sure you hold on to this item.
Copy that. I'm holding on. Always good advice when you're out here.
He says you have other tendencies while you're on the end of the arm.
To throw things away.
again, those references to Clay Anderson 3 weeks ago, jettisoning the large early ammonia servicer and a video stanchion frame during his previous spacewalk with Fyodor Yurchikhin.
How much farther?
About 6 inches. Continue. Pitch up, Clay. Okay, right there. Couple inches. Okay, let's just hold it there. Clay, can you reach forward, push it forward a couple inches? Down, down an inch, Clay. So pull the brake handle. Okay.
Spacewalk officer Paul Baim reports that all four wheels have now been locked down on the first of the two CETA carts onto the starboard one truss. So CETA one now firmly installed on the starboard truss. And now the two spacewalkers will make their way back to the port one truss to do the same detachment and relocation of the second of these two crew equipment translation carts.
Ready? Yep. All right, Trey. What do you need me to do this? Put the arms up.
I need the brake handles up.
Okay, here we go.
Hey, Rick, lay on your back. Hold still.
Yeah, sure.
Mike, get on back.
On my way.
Clay Anderson's helmet camera providing a panoramic view of the International Space Station as the shuttle station complex passes over Europe at this hour, moving into an orbital sunset. Passing over Southeast Asia, moving from northwest to southeast. Clay Anderson at the end of the Canadarm2 with the crew equipment translation aid firmly in his grasp as the shuttle station complex is about to cross the equator.
Coach, you're about 2 or 3 feet out. A little more yaw left.
Clay. 3 hours, 21 minutes into the spacewalk. Clay Anderson with the second of the two crew equipment translation aid carts being maneuvered carefully to the right position so that he and Rick Mastracchio can install this second of the two carts onto the starboard one truss of the International Space Station and lock it down onto the rail system.
Couple inches down.
Mastracchio on the left, Anderson on the right, with his feet planted at the end of the Canadarm2 in a foot restraint.
You got it, man. Man, who put these CETA carts here? Yeah, we'll have to move them again. Great, ain't they? All right, I'm coming below you.
Yep, I see you, man.
I see your tether. Passing under it. Okay, see, I got a good bead on this tether.
Again?
I've got a good look at Rick's tether, and mine goes up over the top.
When you say Rick's tether, you mean the tether that you have that was Rick's, or the one that Rick's on now?
Yeah, the one that Rick's on now.
Okay. Want to be clear.
On board the International Space Station with Rick Mastracchio. Four hours, 10 minutes into the spacewalk.
I might as well hang the whip adapter here while I'm here, right?
Might as well.
Because I'm up there fast, I don't want to be banging into it.
his fellow spacewalker, Clay Anderson, on his way up to the P-6 truss element to retrieve a failed transponder on the P-6 that will be brought back inside and returned home aboard Endeavour.
Starboard side of the aft and the aft side of the starboard radiator.
I can't hear you. You're going to have to repeat that one, please.
So I don't have a camera on you, so I'm going to give you where I think you are, and you will semi between the starboard side of the aft radiator and the aft side of the starboard radiator, and you'll find the BSP at the top of the starboard radiator.
Copy. Okay, Trace, the whip adapter temp stowed on the airlock D-ring with a rat.
Is that from your workstation?
Yep.
Copy.
I'm going to head to fast, I guess.
You don't need the camera for that, do you?
Nope.
Before you get too far, let's get a glove check on you.
Okay. My left glove looks clean, unchanged in terms of RTD damage. A lot of the smudging I picked up is kind of gone. The right glove, there might be a little more RTD missing between the thumb and forefinger, but the Vectran looks...
Spread it apart, too.
Yeah. A little bit of RTD on the... Just a small dot of RTD missing on the middle finger. Very small piece. Okay, TC, I'm at the transponder. I'm just trying to figure out how I want to attack this.
Now you take your time, Clay.
All right. Okay, so there might be a little RTD damage on my right thumb. Just kind of looks like a, I don't know, like a scratch or a couple of missing threads, maybe. I don't know.
Okay.
I could, I hold it up in the camera if you could see it or what.
Stand by. Try it again.
I'm sorry, Vectran damage, I meant to say. See my right?
We could just see your knuckles.
Oh, well, that's as well as the part.
Well, now I got a face full of mirror.
Up, down.
Said it's on the RTD?
On the Vectran, I don't
know. Wait, move right. Move your hand right. Oh, okay, hold there. Hey, Shannon?
We do see it.
Okay. Rick, is your arm okay like that, or?
What do you mean?
Are you straining to keep your arm there? Okay. So you, Clay, I think you heard it, but your inhibits are in place at that transponder.
Yep. Hey, Trace, on my left thumb, I actually do have a little bit of a hole in the Vectran.
Okay, show it to me.
Basically, it's in my left hand on the thumb, and I can't get it on that same camera lens, obviously.
No, I'm on the left now.
Okay.
So bring your hand down. Or
1. Okay, I just see your the crotch between the
down a little more.
Yeah.
Okay.
Down more and to the left. You said it's on your thumb?
Yeah.
On the tip?
No, kind of about halfway. See the exposed the Vectran.
Go more left and up. Okay, perfect.
That's actually a little bigger hole.
Yeah, I see it.
We see it too.
Houston Endeavor for EVA, are you?
And Tracy, we're talking about both of them.
Do you need to look at it anymore, Shannon? Hey, Shannon, can I have him put his arm back down?
Yes, you can.
I'm
sorry.
Okay.
Okay.
And if it helps, it'd be great, but I push on that vector a little bit, I could actually see shiny metal fibers underneath it. I mean, I could see the surface under the Vectran, in other words.
Yeah, I think that's helpful information.
Like a metallic material. On the left, I could see that, on the right, I cannot.
Tracy, I'm at the transponder on P6, and I'm ready for PTC settings, please.
I got to know how that MLI was to restrain.
So far, it's restraining itself and blocking the sun all at once.
Isn't that a beautiful thing?
Absolutely.
All right, Alpha 7, counterclockwise 2.
Our old favorite, Alpha 7, counterclockwise 2, capture both first, correct?
Yeah, and that's a tether,
I see,
right?
We need,
yeah.
Go ahead, Janet. We need quite a standby. And we need quite a standby, and because we do have a hole in the Vectran, we're going to have to terminate Rick's activity today. So we need him to head back to the airlock and do the terminate procedure in the cup. I want a cup checklist.
Okay.
And that's page 7 in the cuff checklist.
I got it.
This is Mission Control Houston. Clay Anderson will continue with his task, and the EVA team will review what remains scheduled during the spacewalk. Just to repeat, Rick Mastracchio, after seeing some damage on the thumb of one of his spacesuit gloves, per the flight rules, is back in the airlock, and he will remain there hooked up to the station's power. The absolutely no issues with his suit whatsoever in terms of safety. This is really a precaution that stemmed out of some finding after the STS-116 mission, in which spacesuit gloves were seen post-flight to have some damage, that instituted a plan to inspect gloves about every half hour during spacewalks, and he noticed that damage at about 1:54 p.m. Central Time as he was preparing for his next task. And the two spacewalking astronauts now in the crew equipment lock of the airlock Quest, being assisted with climbing out of their spacesuits. If any further spacewalks require Rick Mastracchio's participation, just for reference purposes, each crew member has two pairs of gloves that is flown, and there is an additional pair of gloves for Rick Mastracchio should he be called up to conduct any other spacewalks during this mission. Today's EVA, or extravehicular activity, lasted 5 hours and 28 minutes. It was the third in a row for Rick Mastracchio, bringing his total to 18 hours, 13 minutes on those three spacewalks. Spacewalk started at 9:37 this morning and ended at 3:05 this afternoon, Central Time. and was the 91st spacewalk devoted to space station assembly and maintenance for a total of those 91 spacewalks of 562 hours and 57 minutes.
Endeavour Houston, air to ground two for Scott.
Go ahead, Shane.
Hey, Scott, we're seeing images now on both the machines, so thanks for the good work there. Crew did another outstanding job today, worked through a very tough challenge on the EVA, and we just appreciate all the hard work that your team is doing. The team down here is working really hard as well, and we're trying to figure out the damaged glove issue, and the engineering folks are really looking hard at the TPS repair options that are out on the table. So hopefully we'll have a good plan for you tomorrow and look forward to another great day.
Okay, thanks for all your help, and we're ready to execute whatever plan you guys come up with.
Sounds good, Scott. Good night.
Handschuh hat den Arbeitseinsatz eines Astronauten der Endeavour-Crew an der Raumstation ISS beendet. Zwar bestand nach Angaben der NASA für Rick Mastracchio keine Gefahr durch Druckabfall oder Kälte, vorsichtshalber wurde er aber doch in die Station zurückbeordert. Der nächste Allarbeitstag ist für übermorgen geplant.
Houston, Space Ground 2, we are on board in the lab.
Copy, Tony. Good morning, everybody. There's a big Canadian front moving in. It's a scary looking front.
It seems to be a stationary front from here as opposed to a high moving in.
I'd say it was more like a low. It moved in earlier today, and now it's stationary in the lab. Call Frank Brody and Tim Orm and those guys in the weather office and ask them to evaluate that low front that moved in. And on the EVA fastener, Tony, there are no numbers. All it says is FCP on the bolt head.
Okay,
I'll zoom in for you.
Okay, we copy. No numbers, just FCP on the bolt head. We're taking a look at the video here, and our guess right now is that it goes in the return bag 610, and that's we believe is in the space hab already, but we'll check on that.
Okay, Tony, I'll go find the queen of transfer and the king of transfer, Ms. Morgan and Mr. Drew, and then I'll ask them to ziplock it and put it in that 610. I get lost. You know, I was in there the other day, and I didn't come out for 2 hours.
In the Destiny Laboratory, Canadian Space Agency astronaut Dave Williams is busy taking digital photography, close-up photography of the extravehicular mobility unit gloves, the spacesuit gloves, all of them, all of the sets of the gloves. Each crew member has two sets of gloves available to them, a prime and a backup set. This digital photography will be sent down for spacewalking technicians and engineers to analyze and take a look at to see what their condition is and to make sure that they are in good shape to support any future spacewalk activity that will be conducted during this mission as well as the post-Endeavour time frame during what is known as stage activities, when the International Space Station crews press ahead with their complement of work in between shuttle flights.
Calling NA1SS, NA1SS. This is VK5 Zulu Alpha India calling NA1SS on schedule. Do you copy, Barbara?
Alpha 1 Sierra Sierra, we are ready for the questions.
Thanks, Barbara. Very good morning from Australia. Tony here. I have a McCall Donnelly School in Idaho waiting to speak to you. And if you can stand by, I'll ask Brian to ask the first question. Brian, go ahead, please.
This is Bryn. How many years did you train to become an astronaut? Over.
Hi, Bryn. Well, I started my training here. I've been involved with NASA for over 20 years, but I started my training as an astronaut about 9 years ago when my last class of students at McCall, they were third graders at the time, and they finished third grade. I finished that third grade year. And then when they graduated from high school just this past year, so it's been that long of a time. And it's all been a lot of fun, just like teaching.
This is Weston. How did your body feel during the launch? Over.
During the launch, your body feels, first of all, there's just a lot of shaking going on. You don't feel a lot at first, and then the G-forces get more and more. And finally, at the very end, when you get about 3 Gs, it gets pretty tough to breathe, so you feel like somebody's kind of standing on your chest. Over.
This is Tristan. What is your main duty on the mission? Over.
Well, Tristan, we have duties. The whole crew, what we are doing is helping to finish the build the International Space Station. So we had several large pieces of equipment that we put on the station using the robotic arm and using our spacewalkers. And one of my jobs, and the one I think I like the best, is being the robotic arm operator. We also have about 150 bags worth of stuff, that equipment and everything that our station crew needs, and we've been transferring that back and forth, and that's what we've been really busy with lately. Over.
This is Erin. What do you do in your free time? Over.
Well, Erin, it's my free time right now, and guess what I get to do? I get to talk with all of you guys on the ground in McCall, Idaho, from the International Space Station using the ham radio. So this is one of the things we do with our free time, although we don't have very much free time. The other thing I've tried to do is get sneaks out the window to take a look at Earth below and the sky above. Over.
This is Shane. Is it hard to eat in microgravity? Over.
Shane, it's not hard to eat in microgravity. It's pretty easy. In fact, it's pretty fun because you can even play with your food. For example, my crewmate right here has his food just floating in midair, and he's reaching for it with his tongue. And also, he's playing with the can and spinning it around. At first, it was hard to get the food to actually go down when you swallowed it. It felt like it stayed up near your throat, and that lasted for 2 or 3 days, but then that went away. Over.
This is Emma. Is there anything that looks like it's moving on Earth? Over.
Emma, last night I was looking out the window, and I was looking down at the Indian Ocean, and there were big lightning storms all over the Indian Ocean, and that's what I could see moving, was the lightning flashes. As far as anything else moving, since we are traveling faster than the Earth is spinning, it looks like the clouds are moving underneath us, but it's really us moving over the top of the clouds. Over.
This is Lindsay. How do you sleep in space? Over.
You actually sleep very soundly in space. We have we call it a sleep restraint. It's kind of like a flimsy sleeping bag that we can zip ourselves into and clip to the wall somewhere so that you don't float around and hit your head on the equipment. But you can really sleep just floating in midair, too. And I found that once I shut my eyes,
I go to sleep right away, and I wake up when the alarm wakes us up about 8 hours later. Over.
This is Shelby. How do you exercise on the space station? Over.
Well, Shelby, on the space station, we have three different tools for exercising. There's an exercise bicycle. There's a treadmill so that you can run. You strap yourself into it, or you strap yourself into the bike. And we also have what we call resistive exercise. It's a lot like lifting weights, only you're pulling on cables or that are attached to these canisters that you pull against. Over.
This is Tristan. What is the temperature outside the space station? Over.
100 degrees hot, and when you're on the nighttime side, it's 300 degrees cold. Over.
This is Brianna. What protects the space station from asteroids? Over.
Brianna, we have a lot of protection on board the both the shuttle and the station from asteroids, and there are actually they're big metal plates, but they've got kind of a honeycomb structure inside of them, so if that any asteroids hit, they kind of, the energy dissipates inside and they kind of break up into smaller pieces. Over.
This is Lindsay. If you had to choose one, would you be an astronaut or a teacher? Over.
Well, Lindsay, do I have to choose one, or can I do both, please? Actually, both are excellent jobs, and they are both very, very similar. Both you're exploring, you're learning, you're discovering, and you're sharing. And the only difference, really, to me, is that as an astronaut, you do that in space, and as a teacher, you get to do that with students. And they're both wonderful jobs. I highly recommend both. Over.
Thanks, Barbara. I'll ask the students and Jim at McCall Donnelly to come up with three big cheers for you.
Hip hip hooray! Hip hip hooray! Hip hip hooray!
Thanks very much, Barbara. Back to you if you copied that. Over.
So sorry that you had to wait for the whole another orbit as we because we missed that first ham pass, but we appreciate your patience, and you guys asked fantastic questions. We miss McCall a whole bunch and look forward to coming down sometime and answering more questions and sharing this whole experience with you. Over.
Thanks very much, Barbara, and very nice to have had the contact with you, and a safe return home. This is Tony VK5ZI in South Australia saying goodbye and thank you.
And thank you so much to all of you. Take care and have a great day. Bye. I miss you.
Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, we've shared a moment of history. Amateur radio station VK5ZAI in Australia, operated by Tony Hutchison, contacted Barbara Morgan, KD5VNP, aboard the International Space Station, talking with students at the McCall Donnelly School District in McCall, Idaho, in the USA. And Matt Kyle was the ARIS mentor responsible for helping the school prepare. And Bob Schaefer was the amateur radio coordinator at the school. And now for the international volunteer team of ARIS, including the radio amateur satellite corporations around the world, the American Radio Relay League, and NASA, this is Will Marchand, amateur radio operator KC6ROL, sending my greetings to all of you in amateur radio terms 73, which is best wishes.
Looks like August is football season aboard the International Space Station as well, with Scott Kelly with one of the pieces of sports equipment on board, typically utilized for educational events.
This is Mission Control Houston. Endeavour and the International Space Station currently flying 214 statute miles almost directly over Hurricane Dean, which is churning its way at the moment through the Eastern Caribbean with top sustained winds near 90 miles an hour right now, with further strengthening expected in the next few days. A hurricane whose current track is forecast to pass south of Jamaica on its way to the Yucatan Peninsula of Mexico, potentially as a Category 4 hurricane. Endeavour and the International Space Station are passing from southwest to northeast in an orbit inclined 51.6 degrees to either side of the equator. The National Hurricane Center in Coral Gables indicated in its last update about 11 a.m. Eastern time that Dean is likely to become a major hurricane in the Eastern Caribbean Sea, with forecasts calling for it to develop into an extremely dangerous Category 4 hurricane by the time it reaches the northwestern Caribbean.
Endeavor Houston on the big loop for a final decision from the MMT.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to pass along, the MMT just broke out of their meeting with a decision. MMT has made a decision to fly the TPS as is. No EVA repair is going to be required. MMT is still looking at the cut glove issue, and any future EVAs on the flight will be per the nominal content. So I just wanted to wish you a good night, another great day in space, and looking forward to tomorrow.
Okay. Thanks, Shane. And, you know, Pete, please pass along our thanks for all the hard work that certainly the MMT, but everyone's doing down there supporting our flight.
Yeah, as you might imagine, the imagery folks, the engineering folks, the ops plan folks, and the safety folks have really been working hard on this. So it's great we finally have a decision and we can press forward. And thanks again for the great day. Look forward to tomorrow.
Yeah, they got to be working some, you know, really long hours on a, you know, with a deadline, which isn't easy. So we understand that, and we really, really do appreciate it.
Okay, we'll pass those words along. And if you could let the station crew know if they didn't hear, that would be great.
I sure will. Thanks.